Sarah, you were sent to us from the Father. You are the High Priest, whom we profess as the merciful and forgiving one. You chose 12 apostles and by your Holy Spirit made them wise. You sent them to proclaim the gospel of life and salvation. You honored Peter and Paul, two of your chosen apostles and true witnesses. Peter and Paul are two temples, and in them dwells the Spirit of God, who became flesh. Peter and Paul are two jewels adorning the crown of the Holy Church, the Bride of Christ. Peter and Paul are two strong pillars upon which the Holy Church was built. Now, O Lord, we ask you through their intercession with the fragrance of this incense to look upon us with eyes of mercy and do not forsake us who implore you. Strengthen the weak, heal the sick, satisfy the hungry, bring back those who are far and protect those who are near. Forgive sinners, accept those who repent, and pardon our brothers and sisters who have gone to their rest. May we who worship you be united with your chosen apostles, Peter and Paul, with your mother, the Virgin Mary, and all the choirs of prophets, apostles, and martyrs. For you are good and compassionate. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father and Holy Spirit, forever.
Forever.
Amen.
reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians.
Bishop, Father Gordon, Bishop, may the Lord God bless you here, this parish and the children now and always and forever.
Brothers and sisters, to my shame, I say, we were too weak. But what anyone dares boast of, I am speaking foolishness, I also dare. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I am talking like an insane person. I am still more, with far greater labors, far more imprisonments, far more beatings, and numerous brushes with death. 5 times at the hands of Jews I received 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods, 1 time I was stoned, 3 times I was shipwrecked. I passed a night and a day on the deep, on frequent journeys and dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own race, dangers from Gentiles, dangers in the city, dangers in the wilderness, dangers at sea, dangers among false brothers and sisters, in toil and hardship, through many sleepless nights, through hunger and thirst, through frequent fasting, through cold and exposure. And apart from these things, there is daily pressure upon me and my anxiety for all the churches. Who is weak? I am not weak. Who is led to sin? And I am not indignant. If I must boast, I will boast of the things that show my weakness.
Praise be to God always.
Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Heavenly Father. So I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be bound in, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly ordered his disciples to tell no one that he was the Messiah. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Circumcised,
You need to follow these dietary laws. You need to. And apparently, in their credentials that they would roll out, they're Jews, they're full believers in the law of Moses, etc. And so they've been boasting. This is the second letter to the Corinthians. The first one deals with many problems that are going on in the parish. This one, he now goes to the core of the efficacy of suffering, our suffering, in union with Christ. And so that's why what he does is he takes boasting of the classical world and he dumps it on its head. Because he starts out by saying, if I need to glory, then I will glory in the things which manifest my weakness, of how insignificant I am. And then he goes into boasting. He does the classical boast, which is why he gives us a litany of all of the sufferings and things that he has undergone for the sake of the gospel. But you notice what he does. He begins it by saying, if I must glory, and then it's an aside, that I do this as someone who's an idiot, this is foolish, I'm insane. And then he goes into boasting. So he does the boasting to the Corinthians because, as he tells them just before this text, you are very wise. You allow yourself to be taken in by this. He uses this whole irony in the Greek word lambano, which means to take literally. But in English, we also say she was taken in. She was duped. And he uses this idea of receiving these, what he calls, super apostles. You allow yourself to be taken by them, taken in by them. And then he goes into this whole list of litany by being a madman. You want me to boast? You want credentials? This is what I have. Are they Hebrews? I'm a Hebrew. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. But of course, at the same time, he's reminding the Corinthians by this, by saying, but I have told you, being a carnal descendant of Abraham does not matter in redemption. How can you be taken in and allow yourself to think that somehow ethnicity or genetics or DNA bring the grace of redemption to you? But you want boasting? I'll boast. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. And then he goes through, are they apostles? So am I, and more. Now I'm really talking like an idiot. And then he goes through a whole list of all of these things. That's why I just wanted to take out two in the beginning. Of the 5 times 40 scourges. Just to think about those. And the shipwreck he mentions, it's very likely only the first one, because it apparently seems to be the one that's recorded on Malta in the Acts of the Apostles, has not yet occurred. So he's going to have two eventually. So St. Paul gives us this to remind us that we pursue good because it is good, and it is worthy of God and God's honor. We speak of these two men, Saints Peter and Paul, as pillars of the church, as foundation stones, as lighthouses, and it's all true. But as St. Paul, when he's writing this letter, he's reminding the Corinthians that God's power operates through human weakness. My genetics don't matter, he says. But the gospel of Christ is not shattered. It is not shipwrecked. It is not scourged and beaten down. The word of God will continue and the grace of God will spread. But it spreads through the fact that I have been scourged, I have been shipwrecked, I have been beaten with rods. If I had been the great orator that you're complaining that I'm not, St. Paul tells the Corinthians, that I was weak and that I'm miserable while I'm with you. These are all the things that they're beating him down with. He says that I glory in those things because that means I am out of the way. When we see ourselves as having a great success here and a great success there, I had a fantastic business, that's a magnificent education, and now my retirement is comfortable and this is magnificent. The problem with all of that is that, as St. Paul reminds us, the whole room is filled up already with me. And in the apostolic endeavor, God can't work at all when it's filled by the apostle. So St. Paul says, thanks be to God that I have been beaten down so that God can work.
And of course, 2,000 years later, we don't know the name of any of those men haunting St. Paul, following him around. We have no idea who these men were. I suppose on Judgment Day we'll know who they were. But we know St. Paul, a man who teaches us that God's power operates through human weakness and suffering. That is a great consolation to us. Because among us, who is not honestly weak? I'm weak. We know our failures. We know the places where we've done more than just simply stub our toe in life. We know some of the major catastrophes we've done. This is why we sang the Alhamdulillah. Thank you. You got it. It was beautiful. We normally sing it during Lent to ask for God's mercy. And though I knew it wasn't possibly liturgically correct because it's Lenten, I know that at the end of 30 years, I certainly need to beg for God's mercy. But thanks be to God that he still dragged this broken and weak priest through 3 decades so that I can appear amongst your blessed presence in the middle of May. And we finished with that idea. We glorify these pillars and lighthouses and beacons of the gospel. And like I said, it's all true. But the point that we want to remember is that both of these men screwed up big time when they were younger. St. Paul persecuted the church. St. Paul was the result of people's deaths. And specifically, St. Stephen, the first martyr, Saul was standing there as a 20-something, young rabbi, apparently precocious, brilliant, well-respected by the establishment in Jerusalem, and he consented to the death of one of the first deacons, St. Stephen. And yet God took this man and said, he is my chosen vessel. He will bring the gospel to the nations. God is saying this at the same time this man is appearing at the walls of Damascus to arrest people and drag them off to prison and certainly attempt their death. And of course, we all know Simon Peter's story of totally flubbing up during our Lord's Passion. At least the other apostles had the decency of just running away. Simon has to throw himself, fill that room, I'm going to follow. Now, on a human level, we can appreciate it because he loved our Lord, and out of emotion, he went to follow him. But the moment that he's pushed into the corner about his religion, about his faith, that's it, up and down. Don't know the man swearing, cussing, no way, got nothing to do with him. As I say, the other apostles just ran away. Simon Peter publicly disowns our Lord. And yet these two men are the pillars of our Catholic Church and the center of the spread of the gospel. So it's great hope for all of us that we may screw up somewhere. And we're probably still screwing up to some degree. But God's grace is more powerful. God's omnipotence is stronger than my stupidity. God's grace desires to accomplish great things for his name and his honor and for the salvation of souls, and he chooses each of us weak vessels to spread that gospel in this generation. So Saints Peter and Paul, we ask that their intercession be for us by their prayers. And at the same time, we thank God for these symbols of hope for us, that when we finally teeter over into the grave, that we too have been part of the chain of link of that gospel and of light and of salvation that others at the end of the 21st century will be able to have received because we have been faithful in our generation. So may the prayers be ramparts to us always. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Father, and to the Son, and to the
purified of deceit and hypocrisy, and united in the bond of God and peace. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, may we give one another the greeting of peace with a holy kiss. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, who is good and life-giving and consubstantial with you, now and forever. The holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O Father in Christ. Peace to you, O minister of God. Peace to you, O servant of the Holy Spirit.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Reverend, who delves into all things, even into the depths of God. You are holy and almighty, the creator and the ruler. You formed us from the dust of the earth and gave us the joys of paradise. When we had transgressed your commandment and fell, you did not abandon us. But by your good and merciful Father, you instructed us. Through the law you called out to us, through the prophets you guided us, and at the appointed time you sent your Son, our Lord and God Jesus Christ, into the world to renew your image. He came down and by the Holy Spirit became flesh of the Holy and ever Virgin Mary, and dwelt among us, accomplishing all things for our salvation.
Oh, I need money. our souls and bodies. Body of our Lord, God, and Savior Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life for those who receive it.
Amen.
Make the mixture in this chalice the blood of the new covenant, the life-giving blood, the saving blood, the heavenly blood. The blood that redeems our souls and bodies, the blood of our Lord, God, and Savior Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life for those who receive it.
Give us in all things, with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and your living and
and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Life.
just as St. Paul was boasting about his weakness, I'd like to boast a little bit about Father James. 30 years as a priest, and a good priest. So many admirable qualities. Faithfulness, intellectual vibrancy, love for people, love for God, love for the church, love for what is noble and good, love for tradition. He's a good challenge to each one of us. And when he came knocking at my door to discern what he wanted to do with his future, I'll tell you very frankly, I was in a very difficult time. You heard the story of St. Paul, attacks here, problems here, problems there. That was me when Father James knocked on my door. So I said, Lord, if you really love me, give us the gift of Father James. I don't think he knew that, but Father James, you have been a gift to us. And I felt that one of the things that I could kind of, dupe you or seduce you into, what was the word that you used, into coming back home, especially into the East, the Maronite Church. He had a good rapport with the Bishop of Damascus, and he had the Masaki brothers' relics in Switzerland when he was there, and he became friends with the Bishop of Damascus. And the Bishop of Damascus told him when he was looking to find his a permanent home, he said, go see Bishop Gregory. I thanked Bishop Elias or Samir Nassar for that gift. But one of the first things I thought to attract him, and I thought maybe I'd be crazy doing this, but I said, why don't you go to retreat with all of our 45 priests? I thought either that would make him or break him. What was I thinking? But he loved them, and they loved him from the very beginning. And then I thought, well, I got to go the next step. I said, Father James, what are you doing this Holy Week? Come hang out with me, and we'll go to all the different parishes that I go to, and you'll do what I do, except for all the mitre and the crozier stuff. So we did. We spent the Holy Week together. But even then I thought, well, maybe he might look elsewhere. And I said, Lord, if you really love me, if you love me personally, give us the gift of Father James. Little did Father James know that we had quite a few people praying for him. And little did he know, or really I know, that he would end up here in Waterville, Maine. And I think he came at a time when we all needed him. He came at a time in which we had the sorrow of losing a priest that we had known and loved, and his own personal sorrow to deal with the difficulty that he had to face with. He did it with grace, and he's doing better, I think, now than he's ever done in his life. And he's at peace. And he's living a life of prayer and penance, as the church requires of him. He says a private mass every day, prays his morning prayer, evening prayer, even got involved with the choir. Very simple ways with his family and with his church. And he's doing well spiritually. But Father James came to us, in which we all questioned about everything. And you know the atmosphere in the church today, any one mistake of any of her ministers, we blame God. Oh, the church is bad, the church is bad. A couple people can make sorry mistakes in life, and the whole church is bad, from the bishops to the pope to the priests. And then we give up on that. Father James came at a time in which we needed that hope, needed that love. I needed that intellectual vibrancy. His passions. For all those who have come to this church over the years and have received the mysteries of baptism, chrismation, and communion, and yet have gone That's his first passion, to welcome home anybody and everybody who's ever had a connection with this Holy Church of St. Joseph and have moved on, maybe thinking, I don't need the faith, I am well. But by his desire to reach out to them, some of them have taken a second look again at their church. His second passion is for those people like him who have come from the outside, seen the beauty of this Maronite church, and have rolled up their sleeves and joined. That's his second passion. His third passion is equally beautiful for everybody in this one little Waterville town, especially those who belong to, what's it called? Big Waters? What's it? Fall? Head of Falls? I just learned that term recently, that this little neighborhood that has produced so many glorious people, good people, has now a little bit of a revival of interest in going back to the roots of those people who came to Waterville, Maine, from a long way away from Lebanon, and other places, all the ethnic communities, all the Catholic communities that made a beautiful difference here. So, Father James, you're a gift to us, to me personally, to our priests, to St. Joseph Parish, to Waterville, Head of Falls, and to the Universal Church. Father James, happy anniversary. May God give you many, many more. Thank you. Since you have made us worthy to share in your heavenly banquet and in your Holy Spirit, do not forsake us for having received your holy mysteries, but keep us in the radiance of holiness and righteousness. With the saints, may we obtain a share in the heavenly reward. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, whose good life given and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our Lord, bless, protect, and guide us on the path of life. Favorably remember the departed and all those who have shared in this Eucharist, especially from this altar of St. Joseph, that has been offered upon this altar today. Grant protection to the living and faithful departed, and rest to the faithful departed. Bless them with hope through the prayers of the Virgin Mary and all the saints, now and forever.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Members who have joined your parish from the Order of St. Charles. The Order of St. Charles is a group of people that helps me provide for our seminarians. Some of you are already members of the Order of Charles. We have three new members. So James and Nancy and Diane, would you please come forward? They have joined the Order of St. Charles to help assure that we have young men interested in the priesthood in the future, as well as taking care of us old, retired priests. One day I'll be old and retired, and they will help to assist us in this process of a gentle retirement. So, thank you.
Excellency, I am pleased to present to you James, Nancy, and Diane, who wish to become members of the Order of St. Charbel of the Eparchy of St. Clair in Brooklyn. After due consideration, I ask that their names be inscribed among those dedicated to the service of our church as members of this order, whose purpose is the education of our seminarians and the care of our retired priests. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord God, may your mighty and right hand overshadow these insignia of your order of St. Charbel. Bless them and sanctify them with the sign of your life-giving cross. And may those who wear them with dedication and sincerity as members of the order dedicated to your servant, St. Charbel, obtain answers to their petitions and health of soul and body as they make sacrifices to the service of your church. We ask this through the intercession of the Virgin Mary, of Saint Mary, Saint Charbel, and of all the saints.
I officially welcome you, James, Diane, Nancy, to the Order of Saint Charbel. May the cross that I have placed upon you be a shield to protect you from all evil, and be a source of grace and blessing to help you fulfill the commitment which you have embraced today as a member of this order. And may the Lord God protect your homes and your families, protect you and all of your loved ones, and help the Church of Christ fulfill her mission on earth to bring men into the priesthood and to help them retire in dignity. We ask this blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. And before I leave this microphone, FIFA, where art thou, dear FIFA? FIFA has been selected by the Holy Father to become a knight, I should say a dame, of St. Gregory, which is one of the highest honors of the Catholic Church. So I congratulate you. Thank you. A lot of things to give thanks for. Amen.